Good evening and welcome. My name is Tom Looney.
And I'm Siobahn Bhuachalla. I can see a hanaf we've ashiv galair, which means happy Halloween in Irish, where we come from. And tonight, as you may have noticed, we have a third co-host joining us for this scary evening. We've got Porrig, who's an Irish pumpkin. Tom brought him home from his travels across the Atlantic. And he's going to be helping us tonight present all of our fine acts, some of which include the Fury Brothers and Davey Arthur, Barley Corn, Patrick Street, and lots more. And our special tonight.
Yes, we have our usual news and sports, and our special is on the Trinity Dance Academy with Mark Howard. But now to start the evening, here's Barley Corn.
Actually, for the man down here was also for the Kerry song. Some say the devil is dead, the devil is dead, the devil is dead. Some say the devil is dead and buried in Killarney. More say he rose again, more say he rose again, more say he rose again and joined the British Army. Feed the pigs and milk the cow, milk the cow, milk the cow. Feed the pigs and milk the cow early in the morning. Paddy dear, I'm over here, Paddy dear, I'm over here, Paddy dear, I'm over here. It's time to stop your yawning. Some say the devil is dead, the devil is dead, the devil is dead. Some say the devil is dead and buried in Killarney. Or say he rose again, or say he rose again, or say he rose again and joined the British Army. Kate, she is long and thin, she's long and thin, she's long and thin. Kate, she is long and thin, she likes a drop of brandy. Fix her in the bed at night, fix her in the bed at night, fix her in the bed at night, she's Davey Bent the Bandy. Some say the devil is dead, the devil is dead, the devil is dead. Some say the devil is dead and buried in Killarney. More say he rose again, more say he rose again, more say he rose again and joined the British Army. Me wife, she has a hairy thing, a hairy thing, a hairy thing. Wife, she has a hairy thing, show to me on Sunday. Put it in the furrier shop, put it in the furrier shop, put it in the furrier shop, it goes back on Monday. Some say the devil is dead, the devil is dead, the devil is dead. Some say the devil is dead, buried in Killarney. Or say he rose again, or say he rose again, or say he rose again and joined the British Army.
Thanks very much, folks.
Well, the Irish American Heritage Center is becoming popular for many events these days. And coming up this Thursday night, you should mark your calendar. We have a great play there. That's Juno and the Paycock by Sean O'Casey. That's this Thursday night. Now here's some music from Patrick Street. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Well, this is the scary number one night of the year. This is Halloween. And as if it wasn't scary enough to sit here watching us for an hour, we have some more Halloween trivia for you. Because unless you didn't know, Halloween actually originated in Ireland, where we're from, in the Celtic tradition. Did you know that, Tom?
I didn't know that, Siobhan. Tell us about that, will you?
Yeah, we're the original scary people in the whole world. Way, way back, even before Christianity came to Ireland, there was a druidic festival on actually the same day that Halloween is celebrated. And then when the country converted, as you would say, to Christianity, they kept the day the same so that people would keep in keeping with their own traditions and would understand the thing more. And actually what happens is all the souls are supposed to rise from the graves for one last big party bash, I suppose, before All Souls Day the next day, when they finally go to their rest. And so that's why everyone was so scared, because all the souls were on the loose.
Well, when you used to mention All Souls, now I can recall it very much back in Ireland, so we keep up the tradition here, good and bad, I guess. Well, here's time for some music now, and here's the Fury Brothers and Davey Arthur.
Well, I'm going to sing a song now that I haven't sang for a long time. I was asked to do it tonight. I'd like to do it especially for Billy down there, down the back. And this song brings back an awful lot of memories to me. We were in Australia there a couple of years ago. We were in playing in the festival hall in Adelaide. And we got this telegram saying that her ma, Nora Fury, had died back at home. And it took us 2 days to get back. I'll never forget it. And when we got back to the house, it was great to see all the lads, like the Dubliners and the Wolf Tones and Paddy Riley, and the whole lot of them were waiting on us when we got there, keeping the place going and looking after the place till we got back. And I remember going upstairs to where we learned all our music when we were kids, and just sitting down on the bed and having to listen there. And if you started to listen real carefully, you could hear the music coming through the walls. People like Seamus Ennis used to be there, Felix Dorden, Joe Heaney, all these fantastic men, you know, great musicians. And this song always reminds me of that, of going home. And I think it's a smashing song, very old song. It's called The Old House. So especially with Billy down there tonight. Here we go, have a listen to this. They call back to memory those happy days of yore. Gone are the old folk, the house stands deserted. No light in the window, no welcome at the door. And here's where the children that gaze on the heather, and here's where they sail their boats on the barn. Where are they now? Some are dead, some have wandered. No more to their homes shall those children return. All lonely is the house now, and lonely the moorland. The children we've scattered, the old folk are gone. Boys down the hill like their ghosts in the shadows. It's time I was moving. It's time I passed on. Lonely, I wander through scenes of my childhood. They call back to memory those happy days of yore. Gone are the old folk. The house stands deserted. No light in the window. No welcome at the door.
Well, once again, it's time for our news and sports with Eamonn Kelly and Mike Schevlin. Now, here's Mike.
Good evening. A story of the past for this Halloween evening. Last week, archaeologists discovered a track which may be the oldest path in the whole of Europe. The track, which is sunk into the Derryogle Bog in County Longford, is made up of oak and ash logs slotted together. The Archaeology Department of University College Dublin, working under Professor Barry Rafferty, is responsible for this latest find. Professor Rafferty said the path is at least 4,000 years old, and it is the oldest of over 100 paths they have discovered in the area. Samples of the path are still undergoing carbon testing to pinpoint the exact date of its origin. Announcing the find last Monday, Professor Rafferty stressed that the Irish bogs were the envy of Europe because of the high archaeological treasures they contained. But he warned, "We are losing so much each year that something must be done to preserve what is left." The age of the pathway is the one sure thing that the workers can tell at this point. They say it is still a mystery why the road was built, who built it, and where it was leading. And archaeologists this week raised doubts over an old belief revered by modern Irish women. An international conference meeting in Trinity College to discuss the importance of ancient cooking sites has said that women may have done the cooking in prehistoric times after all. Until now, it was believed that it was a policy of men only in the ancient outdoor kitchens of Ireland, while the women hunted, sported with their weapons, or did whatever ancient Irish women did. However, specialists in the area say that this is only a folktale. Victor Buckley, an archaeologist at the Office of Public Works, said they can find no scientific evidence to support the liberated woman theory. One of the major opposition parties in the Republic has said that it will oppose the revision of constituencies currently under consideration if Fianna Fáil stands to gain an unwarranted percentage of Dáil seats. The Electoral Commission has been working on the boundary revision for the past 12 months, but sources say that it is unlikely that the revision, as proposed by the government, will be passed. A Fine Gael spokesman said, "We are already halfway to an election, and if the report isn't substantially amended, that's it." Desmond O'Malley, leader of the Progressive Democrats, said he had hoped that the days of political manipulation were over for good. He said that it was disappointing that what was disappointing was the failure of all opposition parties to join in public condemnation of this blatantly opportunistic exercise. The death has occurred of Ms. Hilary Boyle, a leading Irish political activist and broadcaster. Ms. Boyle was a direct descendant of Lord Edward Fitzgerald, leader of the 1798 rebellion. Hilary Boyle was prominent in many political campaigns, including civil rights in the north of Ireland, the Dublin Housing Campaign, the Anti-Apartheid Society, and Anti-Vietnam War Campaign. On the lighter side, Ms. Boyle was gardening editor with Women's Way magazine, a frequent guest of the gay Byrne Hour, and her prolific, colorful letters to the Irish Times were read and enjoyed by many supporters and opposers of her views. Ms. Boyle died peacefully in Bray, County Wicklow, on October 21st. She was 88. The world premiere of Rattle and Hum, the first movie from Irish supergroup U2, took place in Dublin last Thursday. Every shop, newsstand, office, and restaurant in O'Connell Street dressed their windows with U2 posters for the occasion. The entire thoroughfare was cordoned off from traffic and became an Irish version of Hollywood's Rodeo Drive for the evening. Thousands of people packed the streets to express their good wishes to the local group. Many famous faces from the international music scene attended the premiere, including Enya Brennan, formerly of Clannad, whose solo single, Orinoco Flow, topped the British charts this week. The movie will be on general release in the United States from next Friday. Before we close this evening, Irish Television wants to offer congratulations to some new Irish Olympic champions. The Irish team took one gold and two bronze medals at this year's Olympics, which ended with an aromatic closing ceremony in Frankfurt, West Germany last Sunday. Oh, did we mention these were the Culinary Olympics? The gold medal was awarded for reaching a standard of excellence in both hot and cold dishes. The Irish gold medalist assured all journalists that no steroids were used in the food preparation. That's the news for tonight. I'm Mike Schevlin.
Good evening, this is Eamonn Kelly with the weekly review of Irish sports being brought to you tonight by Craigan Federal and Savings. This time of year is particularly a peculiar time period for Irish sports. In Gaelic games, while the 1988 season just closed with the All-Ireland final 2 weeks ago, the first round of the National Football League last weekend opened the 1989 season. In soccer, even though the League of Ireland Premier Division has been in progress since late August, serious interest in the sport does not usually emerge until early in the new year. While in rugby, the Irish selectors are hard at work, watching the talent in the Interprovincial Championship to build a winning combination for the upcoming international season. As for golf, the season a great one for Irish golfers. It still goes on. Des Smith, who played a major role in Ireland's victory in the Nations Cup 2 weeks ago, won his first European Tour victory last Sunday. He defeated England's Roger Chapman in a playoff to win the Jersey Open and collect $30,000. In Gaelic football, there were some very interesting results in the opening round of the National Football League, as the top four teams in Ireland were defeated. Now let's take a look at the results of games played in both Division 1 and Division 2. In Division 1, Down defeated Kerry by the score of 1 goal and 11 points. That's 14 points to Kerry's 6 points. Monaghan defeated Meath by the score of 3 goals and 12 points. That's a total of 21 points to Meath's 2 goals and 9 points. That's 15 points. Derry defeated Dublin, 1 goal and 7 points. That's a total of 10 points to Dublin's 6 points. While up in Armagh, Armagh defeated Donegal by 1 point, 10 points to 9. In Division 2, Mayo defeated the All-Ireland finalist Cork by the score of 12 points to 1 goal and 4 points, a total of 7 points. Roscommon defeated Kildare, 2 goals and 7 points, that's 13 points, to Kildare's 1 goal and 11 points, that's 14 points. Loud defeated Longford by just 1 point, 6 points to 5. And finally in Division 2, it was a tied game between Cavan and Galway. Cavan with 15 points, Galway with 1 goal and 12 points. That's also a total of 15 points. Well, you know, we're very happy this evening to have in our midst a good friend of mine and all the way from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and that's Jerry Cronin, who is the sports director of the very famous Milwaukee Irish Fest. And with that, I'd like to welcome Jerry to our Irish TV show here in Chicago. Welcome, Jerry.
Well, thank you very much, Eamonn.
You know, Jerry, thank you very much, and it's good to have you here also. You know, I very rarely have missed a Milwaukee Fest, and I have been very happy to be associated with you, Jerry, and also many other members of the committee up on Irish Fest, particularly when it comes to sports. I know that you've attempted and done a tremendous job of of having sports events to coincide with the many other features that have taken place at the Milwaukee Fest. Can you give me some idea what you've done and what role you've played in trying to emerge sports into the Irish Fest in Milwaukee?
Well, Eamonn, as you know, Irish Fest is really shows all the elements of Irish culture and background, and it's while it's primarily a music festival, we have theater and sports and so forth. And in the years gone by, why we've had exhibitions of football, Gaelic football, and hurling, and last year we had tug of war. In fact, it was a team from Boston, the Sons of Erin, who showed very well in that, and I think that'll be an ongoing thing at Irish Fest. We've also had rugby exhibitions. We've had the national champion, the club champion there, and someday I hope we'll have handball at Irish Fest.
Well, you know,
we don't have a facility yet.
Before we close in a few minutes, I certainly would like to touch base with you on handball, because it's a sport that's very dear to me. I still play it, and of course you always played, and a tremendous competitor. And I hope someday that we'll see handball up in Milwaukee Fest. We'll get back to that in just a second. What has made the Milwaukee Irish Fest such a tremendous festival? People come from all over the country, not alone all over the country, but they come from Canada, and they even come from Ireland to see the fest. It is looked upon, I think, as the national festival, the Irish national festival in the United States. What makes it so good?
Well, I suppose it's a combination of things. There's a great group of people headed up by Ed Ward, who you probably know, but a group of about a core of 25 to 35 people who take each individual responsibilities for each element of the festival, but there are about 2,000 volunteers who man the booze and pour the beer and do all the nitty gritty things, and that's what makes it a success. I mean, it's a non-profit making thing, as you know, and,
sure.
And we just want to make it better and better. And last year we had 82,000 people, and next year we hope it'll be closer to 100.
It might be a little premature asking you this. Do you know if there any talent has been lined up for 1989?
Well, you know, we've had everybody from the Chieftains to the Wolftones and Makeham and Clancy, and I'm sure that some of these people will be back next year. I know that the group is in process of negotiating now, and there's nothing hard that's in the bag, but mm-hmm. I'm sure that we'll one day see, or hopefully see, Patty Riley back next year, and maybe a Schooner Fair, and maybe even the Clancy brothers. There's been some discussion about that.
Great. Back to sports again. Do you have any future plans for some events that might be pretty attractive up there? Tug of war, I know you mentioned.
Well, the tug of war thing, you might be interested in this because you're in Irish sports. I just talked to the people from the U.S. Tug of War Association, who came back from Sweden, and the world tournament was conducted there. And Ireland did extremely well. They won the, I think it was 720 kilogram competition, close competition, and I think they finished second in England and in a weight class just below that. You know, tug of war is very popular in Ireland, and we hope that it will be an ongoing thing at the fest, and that perhaps next year we might bring a team like the Bodies from Wexford,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
or some other groups here.
Well, I'm hoping, Jerry, and maybe we've got some listeners who are tuning in this evening who may be interested in this. I know you're very, very interested in having a team competing from Chicago. Maybe more than one team. So anybody who's listening tonight, maybe...
Absolutely. We'd welcome anybody. It will be an open competition. Mm-hmm. And last year we had about 15 teams. People came from as far away as Pittsburgh and British Columbia and Boston, as I mentioned. Mm-hmm. And next year we hope that we'll get participation from Chicago and all parts.
Well, that's great. I know we've had hurling, we've had football up there, rugby. These are all sports, not necessarily Gaelic sports, hurling and football are, of course, but other sports that are played in Ireland have been put on as a showcase up in the Milwaukee Fest. And by the way, for those of you who don't know where these sports take place, it's a field adjacent to the festival ground, and it's very well located. And what I noticed also the last time I was there, that the city of Milwaukee do a tremendous job of preparing the sports field for you.
Well, we're fortunate to have a very cooperative group, and but again, it's a testimony of the hard work of people like Ed Ward and all the rest of the volunteers that do their thing for Irish Fest.
Right, and I know there's some mention here in Chicago of the Irish ladies football who are interested maybe in participating, and maybe in the next couple of years.
We would love to have them if they would come and show up and play on time.
Right, that's true. It's been a problem in the last couple of years trying to get the lads up there on 1
right,
o'clock,
right.
It's usually
you
2
know,
o'clock.
You know, we, back about 2-3 years ago, we had a group from Donemore, and we also had some people from Mayo. From Termacady, and if anybody knows of a club that is coming over, why, we'd love to have them come.
You know, I know we're going to be running out of time, Jerry. We talked about handball, and handball is the other Irish sport that doesn't get the coverage that I would like to see it get, and both of us being handball fanatics, I'd like to just show the handball. Maybe you might want to describe it, Jerry. Or,
well, this,
you know, we're having a hard time getting these handballs right now.
I know, and they breaks it aren't easy. Well, this is the ball that's used in the 20 by 40 court, which is very popular here in the States, and has just come on in Ireland. As you know, in Ireland, most of the people play in the outdoor alleys, as they're called there, the 30 by 60 courts. And of course, that ball's a little bit bigger, and somewhere here, I have a ball here. This
that,
is
that's
typical.
One I think that would be of interest. That's the Irish handball.
Right.
It's played
right.
In a court 60 by
30. 30,
60 by
30 feet, and it's generally open, and it's a little different bounce and a little different game. But the 20 by 40 court is come on in Ireland and since about 1970, and it's I guess I should mention that the young people in handball in Ireland are doing extremely well.
That's great. Well, Jerry, you know, I'd love to keep on chatting with you, and I really appreciate your trip that you've made down here from Milwaukee with your wife Joan and your son Connor. It's been a pleasure to have you here, and again, the long journey down in the rain and the driving conditions had to be pretty bad. Hope we can do it again, and I think it would be appropriate just before the fest, and maybe we can talk about what the sporting events are going to be put on at the fest next August.
Would love to come down and do it anytime.
Great. Well, again, Jerry Cronin, who is the sports director of the Milwaukee Irish Fest, with us here this evening. And again, thank you very much, Jerry. And until next Monday at the same time, this is Eamonn Kelly wishing you all a very good evening. Thank you.
Well, that's the news and the sports for this week, and thanks to Eamonn's guest for coming along to the studio and talking to us. Now, more plugging to do, but this time it's a really good plug. The Dublin City Ramblers, as we told you last week, are coming to the Abbey. They'll be playing here on November 13th, one night only once again. And the good news is tickets are now on sale. Come up to the Abbey, buy your advance tickets. Reservations are by credit card only for financial purposes, but you can buy your advance sale tickets for just $10. Remember, they'll be more expensive on the night, so get in there now. And it's also good to have a good seat. So, Dublin City Ramblers, November 13th, $10 in advance, buy them now. Here's Pat Woods.
Well, this is a song that was written recently about emigration, and it's in fact is currently number one in the Irish charts at home. And it goes a bit further than the emigration bit. If you listen to the words of it, you'll appreciate it better, in fact. It hopes for the day when Ireland will be able to create jobs, enough jobs to keep our sons and daughters at home. The name of the song is The Flight of the Earls. I can hear the bells of Dublin from this lonely waiting room, and the paper boys are singing in the rain. Oh, not long before they take us to the airport and the noise, to get on board a transatlantic flight. We've got nothing here to stay for, we've got nothing more to lose, and there isn't any work for us to do. So farewell ye boys and girls, another bloody flight of ours. Our best asset is our export too. It's not mother fear or famine that makes us leave this time. We're not going to join McAlpine's Fusiliers. We've got brains and we've got vision. We've got education too. So we just can't throw away these special years. For we'll walk the streets of London and the streets of Baltimore. And we'll meet at night in several Boston bars. We're the leaders of the future, but we're far away from home. And we'll think of you beneath the Irish stars. Take a look at Ellis Island and the lady in the bay. As Manhattan turns to face another Sunday, we're just wondering what they're doing to bring us all back home. As we look forward to another Monday. Oh, it's not the work that scares us. We don't mind an honest job. But there isn't any work for us to do. So 1,000 times adieu. We've got Bono and you too. All we're missing is the Guinness and the rain. So switch off your new computers, 'cause the writing's on the wall. We're leaving as our fathers did before. Take a look at Dublin Airport and the boat that leaves North Wall. There'll be no unemployment anymore. For we're over here in Queensland and in parts of New South Wales. We're on the seas, the airways and the trains. And if we see better days, those big airplanes go both ways. We'll all be coming home to you again. There you go. That was the Flight of the Irish. Currently number one in the Irish charts, and of course, it deals with emigration.
And for those of you that enjoy good step dancing, here's the Trinity School of Dance World Champions and the special feature we did on them.
Dancers from Chicago's Trinity Academy have earned the right to celebrate their world champions. Like Olympians, the Trinity dancers proudly display the red, white, and blue after winning the 1987 World Team Irish Dancing Championship. During the last century, British cultural restrictions banned traditional Irish dancing, but early in this century, there was a Gaelic revival. For decades, dancers from the British Isles dominated the field, but in the 1970s, North American Irish dancers began winning solo world championships. Finally, in the 1980s, a North American team took the team dancing title for the first time, and you're looking at them. The Trinity Academy of Irish Dance was founded in 1979 by champion dancer Mark Howard, at the time a student at St. Ignatius High School in Chicago. What makes Trinity work so well?
it certainly isn't me. It's a group of maybe 200 dancers and very supportive parents behind them that run the parents club, and it's a staff of teachers. And really, I have to say, Trinity isn't so much just a makeup of people, but Trinity is more of a feeling. It's just a real nice feeling, real comfortable surrounding.
Mark is a young dancer, qualified, but never won a world title. Knowing how tough the Irish judges were, though, he pushed his students to excel. Even though he is in advanced years, he can still pound out a mean shuffle.
Practice for an hour and a half with the kids. Went home.
The Trinity Academy is not all competition, though. The dancers love to perform. They have performed just about everywhere, with symphony orchestras in front of thousands of fans at ball games and in crowded hockey stadiums. They have even performed atop a bar in an Irish pub. The Trinity dancers even figured a way to get around the long wait for tickets to WGN's popular Bozo show. They dance there. All that practice does have its rewards. These young Trinity dancers are doing a soft shoe jig. Even Bozo is familiar with that dance. Hard shoe dancing, like this treble reel performed by an older student, James Gillespie, is a bit more difficult. More muscles get a workout here. Over the years, competitive dancing has gotten more athletic, drawing from jazz, tap, and ballet. Like the dancing, the teaching has evolved. Mark Howard and his contemporaries draw from a rich heritage.
A lot of these masters of dancing came over to the United States in the 30s, perhaps, and after they immigrated to the United States, they began teaching, you know, in New York, Philadelphia, St. Louis, and they went on to teach other students that went on to teach myself and some of the younger teachers today, and as it went along, it became much more progressively competitive, and today it's very much like figure skating or gymnastics or anything like that. And we have the U.S. and the World Championships. And
when you're after a world title, practice takes on a whole new meaning. Every move is checked and rechecked. But there's a fine line between being ready to peak and peaking. When the World Championships are just around the corner, Mark works on attitude.
Well, the competition tends to give them a little bit of courage and strength. Our school especially, we're lucky in that all our kids get along very well, and I never really stress competition with them when they're young. So they grow into it themselves, and by the time they get into competition, or I should say heavy competition, as far as a national or a world level, they're very relaxed, and they're also very confident with each other, and it's remarkable to watch them before they, say, go up on stage for the world title. They're very loose, and they have an attitude that there's nothing to lose, and there's a lot to gain, but whatever there is to gain is not as important as each other, and I like that in the Trinity dancers. And
years ago, when Trinity started competing, they did it for fun and experience. A world title was the farthest thing from their minds. But over time, they started winning here and there and began to get serious about this competition stuff, but not too serious. In 1985, the Trinity senior team went to Dublin. They figured if they saw a few castles and green fields, it'd be a great trip. They took second place, nearly edging out an Irish team for the coveted title. In 1986, they returned. They took second place again, proving the previous showing was no fluke. But remember, this is Irish dancing, and teams from the Emerald Isle had always won. No team from the United States had ever taken a world title in team dancing and held it alone, no ties, no sharing with any other team. On April 20th, 1987, the Trinity Academy from Chicago changed all that.
Chicago's the home tonight of a new world championship team. It's an Irish dance group bringing back the laurels this time. Family and fans standing by at O'Hare tonight for the triumphant return of the Trinity Academy of Irish Dancers. They took on the world in Galway, Ireland, and danced away with first place. It's the first time any American group has won that international competition. Congratulations to Trinity Academy.
Well, when it comes to an Irish jig, the Chicago Irish are beating the homegrown Irish at their own game. These are the people whose fancy footwork wowed the judges this week in Galway, Ireland. In international competition, the 50 dancers from Chicago's Trinity Academy won first place.
I feel great. I mean, every kid that went on the trip brought home a world-class medal. They've all got their own medals. I've got one in my pocket. And we really stirred them up over there, so we're very proud of it.
The competition's unbelievable, and to win first was just... hard to describe. It was overwhelming.
They were happy, but more importantly, the world team title gave Trinity bragging rights. As Kelly Brennan put it, they beat the Irish at their own game.
Yeah, we beat the Irish, which was amazing for me, because when I think about, everybody thinks of Irish dancing, they always think of the Irish as being the best at it, but when we went over there, we proved them everybody wrong, and we won.
Trinity is best known, in fact, blows away the competition in the field of dance drama, short stories told in dance, song, and narrative, adding the elements of theater to that of dance. This is a production of The Four Scribes, the story of Daniel O'Connell and the founding of his newspaper, The Nation, in Dublin. It's a tale of the power of the pen over the power of the sword. The dance drama is the progressive part of Irish dancing, a chance to convey a message and tug at an audience's emotions. These dance dramas are a collaborative effort between Mark Howard and this man, musician Mike Kirkpatrick. Together, they are the Rodgers and Hammerstein of Irish dance drama.
So we'll decide on what the story is, and Mark will go in and put it on the dancers and see what happens choreographically with the steps and getting these certain ideas across. Then we'll talk a lot about mood and stuff and the forms and the length of sections and stuff. And then I'll go in and do the music with that in mind. It's a thing that sort of makes it a combination of traditional Irish culture and dancing and the Three Stooges.
Right.
While dance drama is a signature of the Trinity Academy, this is too, the treble reel. It's a showstopper. By the way, the 1989 Worlds will again be held in Galway. I've heard lightning strikes twice.
Hello, I'm Bridge Looney, here this evening to share with you the upcoming events at the Irish American Heritage Center. Thank you. Please come and join us at the Irish American Heritage Center. The Heritage Center is just not a cultural center. It's a place for you to come and meet people and work with people. Book your next party at the Irish American Heritage Center. For information, call 282-7035. The U.S. Senate has just approved an immigration bill which would permit at least 10,000 Irish to enter the U.S. almost immediately. The vote was 51-15. Mr. Brian Lenihan, Minister of Foreign Affairs, welcomed the passing and said that one of his government's major concerns has been to encourage the adoption of this legislation in the U.S., which would open important new avenues and opportunities for the significant number of Irish people currently without status in this country, and to enable them to live and work here legally. This immigration amendment provides 50,000 visas and green cards over a 2-year period for those denied entry under the current law. These 50,000 visas consist of 30,000 Donnelly visas, 15,000 in 1989 and 15,000 in 1990. Plus 20,000 additional visas awarded by lottery in 1990 and 1991. The Donnelly visas are for those people who have already applied under the original Donnelly scheme, which was introduced in 1987. The full 15,000 notifications to those on the reserve list will be sent out between now and the end of the year. The procedure of applying for new visas has not yet been disclosed. However, if you have any questions regarding this bill, call the Irish Consulate Office here in Chicago at 337-1868. There are some encouraging aspects to this bill. Congress has acknowledged that there are problems with the existing law and that the Irish, amongst others, have been at a disadvantage. The passing of this bill is encouraging because it indicates that the issue will be brought up again in the new Congress. The effort to have this legislation passed has brought together numerous Irish and Irish American groups in a cooperative and coordinated fashion. It is certainly hoped that this trend will continue. Congressman Donnelly has indeed indicated that he expects Congress to return in the new year to consider more permanent reforms of the U.S. immigration laws. For further information, please call the Irish Consulate Office in Chicago at 337-1868.
Well, playing here at the Abbey Pub for the 1 month of November, we have some great entertainment. Coming up, we have Martin Hayes and Paul McHugh and the Celtic Airs. And all the way from County Tyrone, we have John Taggart, as well as our usual sessions Wednesdays and Sundays here at the Abbey Pub. And Siobhan, finishing off tonight, we have a good number.
Finishing off tonight, we have the boys from Minnesota. We have Paul and Danny of the Irish Brigade. And they're going to close us out because Tom and I are going trick-or-treating now. If you hear a knock on your door late at night tonight, don't open it. It might be us. Until the next week.
good night.
Twas in the month of January, the snow laid on the ground, when over hills and valleys for pleasure I did go. Twas there I spied a pretty fair maid with a soul tear in her eye. She held a baby in her arms and bitterly did cry. Cruel was my father to bar the door on me. and cruel was my mother. This dreadful sight to see, and cruel was my own true love, to change his mind for gold. And cruel was that winter's night, that pierced my heart with cold. For the taller that the palm tree grows, the sweeter is the bark, and the fairer that young man speaks, the falser is his heart. He will kiss you and embrace you until he has you won. Then he will go away and leave you all for some other one. So come on, ye pretty fair young maids, take warning unto me, and never try and build your nest upon the high oak tree, for the leaves they will all wither, and the branches will soon.